This program is brought to you by P. Murphy & Associates, successfully providing IT professionals to Southern California businesses.
Hi, this is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do? And today's guest is Peggy Glenn. And Peggy, what do you do?
Well, it depends on what day it is and what time of day it is, but I have a wonderful life, an amazing life, and a varietal life. Okay. What would you like to hear about first?
Well, let's talk about when you first went into business for yourself, because that was many years ago, so let's...
It was 1985, and it was a really scary jump. I had $45 of the family money to invest in a small flyer to advertise a few books to sell to firefighters.
And what made you decide on firefighters?
That's the best part of the story.
Okay, so tell me the story.
Okay, I was currently married to a fire investigator, and he and some of his colleagues were hoping to find a textbook so that they could teach the person in charge of an engine or a truck is called the company officer, so that they could teach company officers to recognize the signs of a possible setup or a situation where they might get hurt. And the book that they used to teach that was called The Anarchist Cookbook. And there were The Anarchist Cookbook. Do you remember that from the Berkeley days?
Mm-mm.
Well, it was a manual on how to do anarchy within the United States. And I had been in the book business as a publisher and as a writer for a number of years. So when this conversation happened with my ex-husband and his colleagues about, well, we can't find that book anywhere, I said, well, I know where that book is. And they looked at me as if I had three heads. Well, how do you know where that book is? And I said, well, it just so happens that the guy who publishes that book fights and wins a First Amendment battle at least once a year, if not more often. And those articles about that those battles get written up in the trade magazines of my industry, my publishing industry. So I know exactly where to get that book. And I made them a bet that if they would put $20 on the table, I would get the books to them at this conference in no less than 48 hours.
Wow.
Now, this was before the days of the internet, right? So the next morning, and I was out of town, I was in Fresno, where they have a semi-annual conference. These are fire investigators from all over the state of California. And I went to the Fresno library, and I looked up books in print, at the name of the publisher and the phone number. Now, I had been on the other side of the game. I'd been a publisher. So now I just switched hats, and I called the publisher and said, hi, this is Peggy Glenn, and I'm from a firefighter's bookstore. I made up the name on the spot, and I'm inquiring about price and availability of The Anarchist Cookbook, which is the terminology that all others had used with me. And they said, well, it's this much money, and we have plenty in stock, and when and where do you need them? And I said, well, I'm actually going to give you my credit card in advance. I'm going to pay for 20 copies, and if I pay in advance, that's free freight, right? Yes, sure. Now, this was a small publishing company, too, and they were really living on a shoestring because of all these legal battles they had with this book. But I talked them into sending the books out next day air and for half the shipping. I picked up half the shipping, they picked up the other half. And I threw those on the table the next night at happy hour, and you should have seen the looks on these guys' faces. They were investigators, right? They knew how to find out anything.
But they didn't know how to find books.
I had trumped them. And then I realized as I went to the annual conference for booksellers, it used to be called ABA, American Booksellers Association. Now it's called BEA, Book Expo America. And I saw children's books about firefighters, and I thought, well, those would be really handy for the people who do community education. They go into the schools and they read to children, and they show them about the gear, and they teach them about home fire safety. And these books that meet those standards of education, I should be carrying those too. And oh, gee, there's a mystery. That's a mystery about a fire investigator. I should read it first and see if it makes sense, because if it doesn't make sense, I don't want to sell it to these customers. Oh, check it out. there's a book about the Yellowstone fire, which happened in 1988, or there's a book about the Great Chicago Fire or the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire.
Oh, that was, yeah, that.
So I found all these history books, and wow, there's a huge, huge bunch of textbooks from a variety of different publishers, and history books and children's books, and I made sure that I covered the entire fire service from the call that comes in. Those people used to be called dispatchers. Now I believe they're called communication specialists. To the last person on the scene. So there's the planners and the administrators and all the different ranks that people have to study for. The ones who drive the trucks, the ones who investigate the fires, the ones who do community education, the ones who fight forest fires, do specialized mine rescue, do rope rescue, water rescue, river rescue. It took me 20 years, but I had the best dang bookstore ever for firefighters.
Did you think about when you were at that the first one that you went to? Did you think when you were pulling these books that you were going to open a bookstore? What was going on? Because you ordered the anarchist book.
Well, I ordered those books for those guys.
Okay.
And if you've ever talked to a firefighter and told them anything good that they could use, I guarantee you that the firefighter's grapevine took over. It's tell a friend, telegraph, or tell a firefighter if you want helpful news to go anywhere. Because unlike so many occupations, these men and women cannot work in isolation.
Right.
They share information, they share resources, and that's how they get their job done. So when I solved the problem for these guys, they made sure to tell other men and women that I could solve their problem. And then it was, oh, well, if you could find that book, maybe you could find this book. And I knew the tools to find the books. Now there's the internet and everybody can do that. But in 1984 and 1985, there wasn't anybody to do that unless you knew what the tools were. And no, I never dreamed that it would get to the point where it was. But I always knew that if I just paid attention to their questions, mm-hmm, and listened more than I spoke,
right,
that would find my path. That would find my path. And I want to tell you something else. In an early conversation with a couple of my customers, we were just sort of hanging around one day at a small conference. And I overheard, I wasn't even in this conversation, I overheard one guy say, you know, I never hear no when I pick up the radio and ask for something. You know, they pick up the radio, please send me an aluminum ladder. Please send me 6 new cameras. Please send me 3 more guys. Please send me the coroner. It didn't matter what they asked for. The answer was always 10-4, we'll get it. I thought, aha, that's a big lesson for me. When they call me and my little tiny bookstore, which started as a catalog, a paper catalog that people could flip through, when they call me, my first word is not no.
Yes. 10-4, we'll get it.
It may not be yes, but it will never be no. And Marlene, I have to tell you that philosophy has proved to be one of the most important things. It's like a principle of conversation. When someone asks me to do something or asks me if I know something, my first word is not no. It's, that's an interesting thought, or, wow, I never thought about it that way. Or, I'm not sure that I have an answer. Let me look.
Right.
But it's not those two letters, no.
No, I learned that in teaching. I don't know, but I can, let me
right.
look.
Right. And, you know, I'll be danged if I didn't see my daughter employ that same philosophy when she was a single parent. She married a man who was in the military and was away a lot. And she had one perfect child and then one child who needed just a little more guidance. And she told me once that she never told him no when he asked for a treat. She would always just offer another suggestion. So she'd been listening as well. And no was not her first word.
When you were talking to these men, I mean, because you probably knew, I know I'm saying this right, you read all the books. And if you didn't think
I read most of them. except for the textbooks. I didn't understand the textbooks because I didn't do the job.
Right.
But I always read the books. And I knew that public speaking was now part of the job.
Right.
So I found the best, easy to understand book to make them, to help them overcome their fear of public speaking, to give them the tools they needed.
Exactly. So when you were in the business with the fire, and some of the books weren't that good, and they requested that book, and you knew it wasn't really that good, did you say, I have an alternate suggestion for you?
I would often make an alternate suggestion, and I would write my copy. See, this started out as a catalog, so I had the opportunity to skew to add my own impression of the book to the copy that I wrote about the book.
Oh, so you became a critic of the book.
I became a suggester.
A suggester.
Yes,
it's
I was
like
a suggesting you from here to this. Now, when there were two books that were of equal value, it didn't, and equal educational value, equal cost, it didn't matter which one I suggested. If this was the textbook that was required, this textbook wouldn't do.
Right, exactly.
So that's when I would carry two of the same thing. But I figured that if I wrote from my heart, they would trust me. And the business built from 7 or 8 people who I, those first 20 guys I bought those books for, to 750,000 customers when I sold it in 20 years.
Oh my God.
A lot of it, word of mouth. Well, you find one firefighter, you're gonna find two more at least.
And you're in such a niche market.
In such a niche market, but they live in groups. Even in a single unit fire station, there's at least three, right?
I don't know.
Okay, so you got an engine, you have a fire engine.
Right.
There's the person who drives it, the person who's in charge, and the person who pulls the hose. That's three.
Okay.
You add an ambulance, that's two more.
That's
you add a truck into that station, and you have four more if you're lucky, or you got three. So now you have 8 people in one fire station. You make one of them happy, you make all 8 of them happy. When they're happy, when their needs are met, like I said, they share. So the business just grew with heart and grit and sharing.
How long were you? Did you do the catalog before?
I did the catalog until the internet became the deal, and I want to say it was the early, very early 1990s.
Right.
So there was 6 or 7 years, and until the early 2000s, I still printed either on paper or on CD a print catalog.
Okay, and did you have a bookstore too?
After a while. Okay. This whole thing started in my house. Started in the house, and when there, we had a long skinny house, and the first third of it was 3 bedrooms that we didn't use because our kids were all grown and out of the house. So there was bedroom 1 was the office, bedroom 2 was the warehouse, and bedroom 3 was shipping. And the bathroom, finally I put a piece of plywood over the top of the bathtub so that I could put more shelves there. And there were shelves lining the little hallway. I thought, that's enough. That's enough. And a space opened up in an industrial building directly opposite, on the same side of the street as the Regional Fire Training Center in Huntington Beach. I thought, well,
wow, that's perfect.
This is perfect. And then I got permission to put a gate in the fence between the two of us so the people didn't have to walk around to come into our building. They could walk right through the fence.
Wow. So did you go, I mean, how did you promote it? You didn't have to promote it.
Well, it promoted itself, but I also showed up wherever there were going to be a bunch of them. Once or twice a year, there are different training conferences around the country. I first settled on California because I needed to get my money close and my expenses close. So I would go to the annual training conference in California, and I always did honor those fire investigators who were my first customers. And I always went to their training conferences, which were twice a year. The training officers, those who trained the others, their conference was once a year. And then I branched out, and there was a huge conference in Baltimore, Maryland, once a year in July. Baltimore in July.
Right.
And
right.
Then there's another that...
They got it cheaper, that's right.
Right, right. This conference used to be, I've completely forgotten. where it used to be, but it moved to Indianapolis and is now moving to Memphis. And it's like the granddaddy of all fire conferences, fire training conferences. This is where people go for education. So I would pack up my books and ship them on a truck and spend several hours setting it up. And by now I had staff, of course. But from the beginning, from the very first day, I was computerized.
And so that was in 1984?
1985, 1986.
Year,
I had a PC with a gray, a black screen with green letters on it. But I had a database, and I kept every one of their names and addresses. And just about that time, there was software that came out to run direct marketing businesses or mail order businesses.
Really? Because I wasn't involved in that.
I learned about it when I went to a home-based business conference. And here was these people advertising this software. And my gosh, if you put the address in and the customer called the next time, up it popped. And you could look like the genius of the century.
You didn't have to go through your Rolodex and everything else.
No. And it held their credit card numbers. It held their address. It held their shipping address. It was a list of everything they'd ever purchased. It was everything you need to know about your customer to be able to serve them quickly, efficiently, and get them off the phone. Because most of them were men, and you know, men are a little phone phobic. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They really don't like to make phone calls.
No, that's true. And this was, I got my first PC in 81 or 82, so this was the beginning when it was just starting off. And what made you?
286. I had a 286.
No, I had the older one than that. So what made you do this? I mean, why did you?
Well, once I got 6 or 7 months into it, I couldn't get out of it.
Right.
And I was in love with it.
PC.
Not the PC. Really? I was in love with the notion of finding stuff for people who needed it. And it was only much later in my business when I learned that I had found a niche and filled it.
Well, that's what, you just seemed to drop into it.
I dropped into it because I listened. Again, I listened.
But you had the smarts to say, okay, I need to learn this. You knew what you're going to learn. I mean, if there's a children's book or this book, somewhere in your mind, you kind of pieced it together.
Well, I'd been married to this guy for about 10 years, and I had listened to him talk about the various aspects of the fire service and how it all has to work together, or it's not a cohesive fire department. If administration hasn't bought you trucks and planning hasn't fixed the roads and the new developments and the dispatchers aren't going to take the calls and send you where you need to go and the guys on the trucks and the women on the trucks aren't trained, they're not going to be able to fight the problem. And you got medical aid as well, so those guys have to go to paramedic school, and then there's people in the ambulance, and someone's going to go fight a forest fire. Well, they have to learn how to do that. And all of us people who live in suburbia, we're going to be part of the task force that goes to fight that fire somewhere else.
Exactly.
So I learned by listening to him, and his passion was so strong, that the fire service was an integrated body. It wasn't a bunch of rogues out doing stuff, because if you go off and do something on your own, and it all turns to manure, you're in bad stubble. You're just not where you need to be. So teamwork was.
And they're going to get rid of you too if you're a rogue or.
You're not going to fit in. You're not going to necessarily be fired, but you're not going to fit in. So you're not going to feel good. So you're going to leave and find something that fits you better. I found that the fire service, for the most part, was a very friendly, compassionate, team-oriented, loving bunch, in the way that people who work together tightly can love each other, if you know what I mean.
Oh yeah, I know.
Everybody's got everybody's back, and they had my back as well. So that was pretty cool. There were a few times when being a woman in the fire service, mm-hmm. or selling something to them, was a little bit different, but I was selling a commodity that made sense for a woman to sell it. This was still the mid to early 80s and 90s.
I know.
And so I, a librarian and bookseller and researcher, perfectly acceptable woman's job. Mm-hmm. If I were to try to sell them boots or trucks or helmets, I imagine that those women had a different struggle. But let's just say that I never struggled. I just felt it was the best job ever. I had happy customers. They were never disappointed. If something happened, I took ownership of it immediately. And but I, you know, I watched what these guys did, and I watched how they recovered from a problem, and I just learned from them. And I thought, if I can emulate their behavior, then I will be one of them, and we will be a team together in this. And so then people were suggesting books that I should carry, and it was just one of those sort of symbiotic, endless loop kind of things. It was an awesome time in my life.
Yeah. I was going to ask you, you stayed there 21 years, right?
I owned it for 21 years, yep. And I was approaching what I thought was retirement age. Well, all of my customers who got, they got their first job because they read this book that I sold them. Now they're retired and I'm not. What's wrong with this picture?
Right. Did you want to retire?
After a while, I did, because my marriage to Mr. Fire Investigator ended about 10 years into the business and 20 years into the marriage. So now for the last 10 years of the business, I was single, and I had wonderful staff. I had enough margin in my business that I was able to take time off, and I had a bad case of wanderlust. I've traveled to Australia. When my daughter lived there for 3 years, I traveled to the UK to follow a musician who I really enjoyed, with friends who also enjoyed her, so we were also sightseeing. I traveled all over the United States on a whim. Sometimes I would pick up and go because I was buying my merchandise with my mileage credit cards.
Oh, yeah.
To get points. So then I had all these miles that I could use to go somewhere.
That's wonderful.
So it was a magical time in my life. I had the best customers, the best staff, the best suppliers.
And you could go visit your...
And I could go do stuff.
And you could go visit your clients when you went on a trip. You can go to...
Oh, absolutely.
A couple of days or weeks to take...
Oh, and if they were going to have a training session and needed me to bring books, business expense.
Right.
You know, I didn't abuse it, because that's not my integrity. But I had the opportunity to be face-on with them, because most of my relationships with them were over the phone. Even though the internet was a big deal, there was still the phone conversation.
Exactly.
To make sure that this was what they wanted, to offer an extra level of connection, because the more connected to me they were, the less likely they were to have any issues with their order.
Right, right. And
now,
they always trusted you.
Over time, the internet changed even my specialized bookstore.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Because the publishers, unlike many industries, the publishers of books will sell directly to consumers. Not just training sites, but also direct to one-on-one consumers. And then there's Amazon, and then there's Barnes & Noble Online, and lots of other small specialized bookstores. And then the state of California Fire Chiefs Association had a little bookstore. They formed together with Western Fire Chiefs, had a bigger bookstore. And that was also kind of moving me in the direction of, I don't want to fight for my work.
Right. Yeah.
I don't want to be adversarial. It wasn't in my comfort zone.
Yeah, I can understand.
I'd been in my happy place for so long, I didn't want to go there.
And I know even small niche bookstores take a hit with Amazon and Barnes & Noble. We have Vroman's here in Pasadena.
Vroman's is an institution.
And it's an institution, and I really try to support Vroman's. I really do. I go over there for the books. They're so nice, and they have beautiful... I hate to shop, but Vroman's has a lot of nice gifts too, so I can do it all in one.
Yeah, it's a great space, and they still have two stores.
No, they have the one store.
Just the one there in the mall, next to Whole Foods, right?
No, they're in, they have...
They have one in Old Pasadena.
They have their satellite, their smaller stores near Hastings Ranch, is in Hastings, and there's the downtown.
Right,
but
right.
But they have the...
I love the downtown store.
Oh, the downtown, well, I always ask to please ship it over to the Hastings Ranch, because it's there when I go, so I don't have to go to downtown Pasadena unless I want to go to downtown. But they, you know, I still go. I mean, they do phenomenal work.
Well, you see, right there, you just mentioned the key word.
They were willing.
Seven letters, service.
So they were, yeah. I called them and they said, well, it's going to come in here. I said, well, can you deliver it over to Hastings Ranch? Oh, sure.
And they have runners back and forth between the stores. And service is what always set me apart. And even as I was getting ready to groom my business to sell, you know, making sure all the records were in order and it would look exactly as it was, so there was no question about what is its profitability, what is its customer base, what is the supplier relationships. Even as I was doing that, service was the number one thing. As I surveyed my customers, why did they come back to me?
Service.
Service.
Did you ever get into Europe?
Well, we shipped books all over the place. We had a huge military customer base. Because the training that domestic firefighters get, the military firefighters get that, plus all the aircraft rescue and combat firefighter training as well. So they're training at any U.S. military base worldwide. And so we would ship to APOs, PPO, APO, FPO, and whatever the one in the center is.
What did they stay?
APO is Atlantic. Oh. FPO is... over west,
okay.
And there's one more.
Oh, okay.
But they're, and sometimes if we had a large shipment that had to go on pallet, we would send that to a distribution center. There's a huge distribution center in Tracy, California, where the big Air Force Base is, and there's another on the East Coast. And so then they would bundle that stuff up and put it on a plane and take it where it needed to go.
Wow. So now it's what, 2005, 2006, and you decided?
It's actually 2008.
Okay, you're 2008.
I'd been trying to sell it by my 60th birthday.
Okay.
Which would have been 2004.
Okay.
That didn't happen. But then I found the perfect purchasing person, purchasing company, and it took about 2 years of back and forth information sharing and negotiating and more information sharing and more visits and that sort of thing. And on December 1st, 2008, I sold my business. And then I worked for the new owners for a couple of years. And I'm sure any business owner you talk to will talk about what an interesting time that is in their life.
It's very hard for business owners. It never works. It really doesn't.
It worked better than I thought it would. And probably the best thing to come out of it is that when I, about a year into this, I experienced some medical issues, and I had wonderful health insurance, disability insurance, a paycheck, sick time, paid vacation, and Medicare, because now I was 65.
And you didn't have that for you.
And I didn't have that if I'd sold it at 60. So all things happen for a reason. I have a phrase that I use a lot, and you had sent me a question about if I could live five lives, which ones would I live?
Yeah, I find that an interesting question.
I would live my own life five times.
Okay.
Because who I am today, the way I make decisions, and the way I treat people and hope to be treated back, and the way I interact is a grand result of every journey and every decision, good or bad, smart or not, and every person I've met, every side road I've taken. Who I am today is all those places I've been along the way.
I like that.
And I wouldn't want it to be anything else. I really wouldn't. I can't imagine living any other life than the one I've lived.
Well, you're still living it, so let's go on.
I am still living it, and living it to the fullest. It's a grand adventure every day.
Well, so let's talk about, because I think this is important. You retired.
And then I did.
Transitioned into your next
I transitioned into pretty much nothing for about 3 years.
Okay.
I didn't realize how tired I was until I had the opportunity to not have to work. So I worked for the new owners for about 2 years. So that takes us to 2010, the end of 2010. Right. And it was just 15 months ago, which it would have been 2014,
right,
that I thought, now that I've fallen in love with the most amazing man on earth and moved from Huntington Beach to Sylmar.
That's a big move.
For love, people. Any move will work for love.
That's a huge move.
From Huntington Beach to Sylmar.
Yes, I know.
For love. Well, gee, I'd always thought, in fact, I used to keep a list of some of the things I wanted to accomplish in my life. And one of them was I wanted to be in the movies.
Okay.
I don't know why. I didn't know what it was, but I wanted to be in the movies. So, gosh, I'm close enough that I could try this out. So I signed up for a couple of online services where you find out about jobs. And my very first job was just over the hill here in Pasadena at the Art Center College of Design. I was hired by a couple of young men to play a hospital patient in one of the scenes they were doing for their end of semester movie. And I could do hospital patient very well. But something happened that day, Marlene. There was a connection with those brothers. They're 6 years apart, the same, very much the same age as my two grandsons. 6 years apart, raised in inner city Cleveland, both of them on full scholarship at Art Center College of Design. One as a postgraduate student, having achieved his business administration degree at Kent State, and the other as an undergraduate, straight out of high school. An arts high school, we might mention. We connected. And I gave them my card, and I said, call me for anything else you do, because there's magic connected to you two. And I'm not much of a woo-woo person,
right?
But there was magic. There was magic in the way they communicated what they wanted with every person in that little scene that I did, and the way everyone responded to them. And all of a sudden, here's this same teamwork that I spent 20 years in, right?
You found it again.
I found it again. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
And those patterns.
So they called me and they said, well, we want to do this commercial. It's a fake commercial, but we have to do a commercial for class. Would you wear a racing helmet and gloves and boots and make believe you're in a race car? Heck yeah, sure.
So you went down to the rental store?
No.
No, you went and bought it?
They brought this helmet, and I'm not going to give away the punchline, but I drove this car in my driveway, and they making sound effects and all this stuff, and the last scene of the movie lets you know that, well, I'll just leave it there. I'll just leave it there. Because it's on their website. May I share it?
Yeah, sure.
It's thenextlevelbrothers.com. Thenextlevelbrothers.com. Because they take everything they do to the next level. And they're just so cool. So I'm doing this, right? I've done two. Well, clearly I'm made for this, right? I've done two. So I find out there's a place that you can sign up to be an extra at the movies. And, oh, here's a place where you can sign up to actually do a role. Well, what qualifications do I have to go out and do a role somewhere? Hello, I've lived now for 70 years.
Right, right.
If what I have and the essence of me is what will help you tell your story, then let's get it done. So,
Is that your tagline?
No, I just made that up right now, talking to you.
It's a good tagline, by the way.
I'll have to remember that.
If who I am, and
the essence of me is what you need to tell your story, then let's get it done. I like that.
Okay.
I like it a lot.
You got that.
And, you know, I've done everything from appearing to be mute with Alzheimer's, and I drew on my brother's late wife's experience, young onset Alzheimer's at 60. And at some point, she was just a blank slate. So I drew on that for that role.
It's so hard as a family to watch it.
Oh, it was agonizing to watch my brother go through it. But it's been lovely to watch him move forward from that. And I've played a dying grandmother. I've done a lot of comedy things. And so here I am, a member of team again.
Yeah,
and communicating.
And you were on one of our shoots.
I was on one of your shoots. I was the one you picked because, I guess, the essence of who I was. And, you know, I had a lot of misgivings when I came into it.
Really?
I did, because I'm a little bit sensitive about the fact that at 5'3", I weigh over 200 pounds.
Right.
I'm not a skinny girl. And all those years of singledom, that chubbydom was not the desired trait, right? Until I met the man of my dreams, who says it doesn't matter what I weigh, it matters how I care. And if I'm fun, and if I'm smart. And but it turns out that I seem to be everybody's favorite chubby Caucasian grandma. Or best friend, or yesterday I did a shoot where I was like a combination Julia Child, Betty White. Put those two together.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do in my head, yes.
Yes, and you know, it's just, it's magic. It's magic. There are a couple of bits about the film industry that give me a little grief, after, particularly after 20 years running a well-oiled machine business,
right,
where I knew exactly what was going to happen in terms of planning and events. I knew what was going to happen. Every day was different, and that was another one of the beautiful things about it, was that every day brought something new.
Right.
But on this day, this happened, and on this day, this was going to happen, and you had to plan for this many days in advance. And if you were going to go do a trade show, which I sort of equate to making a movie, you have to plan it out this far in advance. You know where you're going to go, how many people you're going to need, how much it's going to cost, how you're going to feed them, how you're going to get them there.
The film industry doesn't work that way.
No.
It's chaos, I know.
And on top of that, they work 13-hour days. And I was reading through Gary Marshall's book recently, My Happy Days in Hollywood. He's talking about something in the 1960s and 70s, 13-hour days then.
Yeah.
I'm thinking to myself, how is it that risk management has not put a stop to this? Accidents, broken equipment, broken people on sleep deprivation. I don't understand how they work.
Well, they pay the overtime.
Well, pay the overtime is not going to repair a broken family or a broken potty.
Well, I think when they're in it, they're like police officers who are working all these hours.
But they do them 7 and 8 and 13 days in a row.
I know.
I did one network TV show where I was extra. 3 13-hour days. It took me a week to recover from that. So I'm a little more selective about the parts that I submit for now. I don't submit for something that's going to be many days in a row, weeks in a row. I submit for the things that will be the right fit.
Yeah. Well, you were talking when we first met you here. We were shooting the YWCA, and you were talking about it has to be a fit. You were very clear that, and I think where a lot of actors or actresses get their own ego involved, you don't seem to have the ego involved. Either that it's going to fit you or it's not going to fit you, and that's the way it is.
Right. I made up another saying. It's actually on my website, that being an actor and finding a role is auditions are akin to buying a new pair of blue jeans or buying a bathing suit. You could hit it the very first time you go in the store. You could try on jeans in every store in the mall.
Right.
You could order stuff from a catalog. You could put it off for a week, and you spy one in a store you weren't going to go on. That's the right one. So it doesn't mean those jeans or bathing suits were awful or you weren't any good. It just means you had to find the right fit.
It's always about the fit.
And
you find, you know when the right fit comes.
You do.
Something.
I knew that in the relationship when Mr. Wonderful showed up.
He just came in and you knew?
Well, what's weird, really weird, is that we were in the
same... firefighting too?
No.
Okay.
He's a musician.
Okay.
And we'd been in the same music community for the better part of 4 or 5 years. He's the bass player of a band I followed But I was always interested in the lead singer because he was the one who wrote the songs and sang the songs. They sang backup parts and played backup instruments. And I'm tuned into the words and the story. That's why I like the movies too. It's the story.
It's a story. And that's why I like what I do, because I hear stories.
Yeah, you hear stories all the time.
I love to listen to
it. It's gorgeous. Yeah, it's gorgeous.
I have a good time.
So, you know, I never had spoken to him, even though we'd been in the same place many times over the 4-year period. But then, and I'd heard about him. I'd heard about this guy. He was a widower. He was salt of the earth. He'd taken care of a dying wife for 10 years plus of the 14 years they were married. Never, ever abandoned her, left her side, left her wanting for anything. He was always the first person to answer when you needed help moving or doing anything, and never, ever the first to ask for help himself. I'd heard about this mythical guy. Well, there couldn't be anybody like that, right? We're at a New Year's Eve party. He looked me in the eye. I looked back. Bam. Bam.
That's great. That's great to hear that you know, at this age.
I'd been single 18 years. He'd been widowed 5 plus. And we're 3 years into it in just a couple of months. And it's a really nice, happy place. I'll tell you one thing about making movies, though. I don't get out to see as many because I'm practically working full time.
I thought you were retired.
Yeah, I'm right. But, you know, he's a musician, so he's got practices and rehearsals and gigs.
Right.
And we saw each other this morning when we got up, and we'll see each other tonight when I get home.
From the vintage store.
From the vintage store and my acting class and stopping at the grocery store so that we got something for breakfast, unless I check with him and he already did it.
Well, thank you so much for stopping by and sharing all this. I mean, it's a really, really fantastic story for people who are in transition. I mean, how do you do transition?
You do transition by knowing who you are, knowing what fits for you, and making choices based on your life philosophy. I don't do anything if it's not fun. You know, we had some technical difficulties setting this up. We got started almost 2 hours after it was supposed to go.
Right.
Who cares? It's still fun.
Oh, yeah.
I got to tell my story. I got to hear a little bit of yours while we were waiting.
Exactly, exactly.
And that connection.
Yes.
And if you're not the kind of person who wants to be connected, then maybe your transition is something that allows you to do something solitary.
If you feel like you've been connected all your life and you just...
Yeah, and you just want to unplug. There's plenty of things to do for that, too.
Right, right. Well, thank you for coming by.
Thank you for asking.
And you want to state your name and your website over here.
Hi there. I'm Peggy Glenn. That's G-L-E-N-N. And my website is peggyglenncreative.com. And you'll find all sorts of pictures and video clips and a little bit of my life philosophy right there.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you again for asking.
You're welcome. This is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do?
This program is brought to you by P. Murphy & Associates, successfully providing IT professionals to Southern California businesses.